Graptolites alive. That sounds like an exaggeration, but the title of the article that we'll be spending a good share of our time on is entitled, It's Alive and It's a Graptolite. It's found in Discover Magazine, and the website is there. It's by Kathy Svito, and date is July 1, 1993. I realize that that's a little ways back. But I don't think that the discovery has made as much impact as it might perhaps should have done. And the first paragraph goes, from the seafloor off New Caledonia comes a strange colonial creature that was supposed to have been extinct for 300 million years. When naturalists in the 19th century began to turn their attention to the deep sea, they expected to find it crawling with living fossils. Darwin had taught them that organisms evolve in response to a changing environment, and since the environment was in the deep never changed, or so it was then assumed, I wonder what could have changed it. There was no reason for organisms there to evolve at all. The assumption was wrong. And for the most part, the search for deep living sea fossils has been a disappointment. Well, in the meantime, that finding that the assumption was apparently wrong has been translated into, oh, we don't expect them to be around anymore because it's been too long. So here you have evolution that can predict anything, as long as it knows what it's supposed to predict. But there have been some notable exceptions. In 1938, a South African chemist and amateur ichthyologist named J.L.B. Smith, staring at a sketch of a fish netted off Madagascar, realized he was looking at a coelacanth, a fish that had been thought to be extinct for 100 million years. Sometimes called a coelacanth, for what it's worth. I'm pronouncing it the original Greek way, more or less. And in 1992, Noel Dilley, sorting through a pile of unlovely organisms retrieved by French oceanographers from the seafloor off New Caledonia, found himself looking at a graptolite, a strange sea creature that last seen alive around 300 million years ago. Well, I don't know who saw that creature 300 million years ago, even assuming the time scale, but whatever. I don't want to sound arrogant, says Dilley, an amateur marine biologist and professional ophthalmologist at, whoa, I didn't know the doctors were allowed to meddle in these things. I guess if you say the right things, you can. Ophthalmologist at St. George's Hospital Medical School in London, but I feel I must almost be in the same bracket as Dr. Smith. Here I am, a complete outsider who, by virtue of an incredible stroke of good fortune, has stumbled across something that is very exciting and very interesting. Actually, Dilley is hardly an outsider in marine biology. He's considered one of the world's leading authorities on pterobranches. Colonial animals, somewhat like coral, they're colonial, and therefore they're somewhat like coral. Their structure is different, but that's okay. That attach themselves to the seafloor at depths ranging from 2 to 2,000 feet. They can be that close to the surface. A pterobranch colony is typically an inch or so wide. It consists of a hardened mass of collagen inhabited by tens of zooids, the individual members of the colony. Each zooid is less than a tenth of an inch long and lives in its own tube or tiny depression, depending on the species. The zooids crawl out of these holes to filter microscopic plankton out of the water with their wavy tentacles. As they're eating, they're also secreting collagen from a sucker-like organ near their mouth. Thus, the colonial skeleton is built up layer by layer, much like a plaster cast. For more than 50 years, some researchers have suggested that pterobranches must be related to the graptolites. a group of marine organisms that flourished throughout the world ocean between 570 million and 300 million years ago. Like nearly all fossil organisms, graptolites are known only from their hard parts. But those hard parts look very much like terebranch hard parts. They are colonial skeletons with individual tubes or holes called thicae that presumably housed zooids. And they appear to have been built in the same way as terebranch skeletons, of layers of material secreted by the zooids. Now, skeleton is a misleading term here, as we'll find out, because it's really more like honeybee honeycombs. It's completely outside of the animal. They secrete these homes, if you like. It's more like coral, where the individual organisms live inside or partly inside of the calcium carbonate thing that they secrete. Some graptolites attach to the seafloor, and those looked either like a bushy seaweed or like a flattened bagpipe, with thicae protruding from a skeletal blob. But many graptolite species floated in the water, and their skeletons resembled hacksaw blades, with each tooth a theca, or a place for the zooid to live. These little blades have been beloved of geologists for more than a century. Because graptolites were floating organisms, they were widely distributed by ocean currents, explains William Berry, a geologist at the University of California at Berkeley. More importantly, the shape of the little hacksaw blades changed quickly over geologic time. Sometimes there are cups on one side of the blade, sometimes on both sides, sometimes the blades form a V or a Y. Once you understand the pattern of change, you can date the layers in a geologic structure relative to one another based on the relative positions of graptolite deposits. And in Australia, you can find gold because of it. In spite of the physical resemblance between graptolites and terebranches, though, some paleontologists have balked at putting them in the same class. That's because it's been evolution and it has to have changed. And we can't, you know, you can't have something that stays the same over 300 million years without showing anything in the geologic record. See, if the terebranches were, in fact, graptolites, then that would mean that they're living fossils. One part of the graptolite skeleton, a long, thin spine called the nema, could not, these researchers have argued, have been formed in the way terebranch zooids formed their skeleton, through successive layering. A zooid, the argument went, could not have left its theca, climbed up a spine many times longer than its body length, secreted material at the tip, and still have remained connected to the colony. It had been washed away or something. In fact, in some species of graptolite, it seems the zooids couldn't leave their theca at all because the openings looked to be smaller than their bodies. How do you squeeze through that opening? But the linchpin of the argument against saying terebranches were living graptolites was simply that no one had ever found a terebranch that built a nema, a little thin thing that sticks out of the colony. Enter the French research submersible Siena and a French marine biologist named Michel Roux, who collected a batch of terebranches off the coast of New Caledonia and sent them to Noel Dilley for sorting. And skip over a little descriptive paragraph there. The things Dilley spied under his microscope, he called them cephalodiscus graptolitoides, were orange-colored colonies of terebranches consisting of a flattened crust of collagen peppered with sac-like cups. Each cup contained a single white zooid between a 25th and a 10th of an inch long. That's 1 to 2.5 millimeters. These are little bitty creatures. And in many cases, fatter than the door to its home. Yet these zooids were clearly capable of squeezing out. Near the cups were long, tapered, needle-like spines that looked for all the world like a graptolite's nema. Some of the spines were more than an inch long, nearly 300 times the body length of a typical zooid, and at this, and the same length as the impossible for a tear branch to build, Nema. When Dilley examined the spines under electron microscope, he found that their internal structure was the same as that of a Nema, with layers of collagen piled one on top of the other from the bottom of the spine up. I've examined electron micrographs of the ultrastructure of floating and bushy kinds of graptolite, says Barry, one of the people quoted above, and the patterns in those 400 million year old forms are identical to those of Dilley's tear branches. If I was shown pictures of these spines, I'd say it was a graptolite. The zooids, Dilley suspects, use spines as feeding poles. It's no good filter feeding down from a deep dark hole, Dilley explains, or from the bottom on the bottom in the mud. The place for a filter feeder is out in the current. I think the Nema is just a gadget that allows the colony to get off the bottom. Each time a zooid coils or squeezes out of its hole, Dilley says, it leaves a trail of collagen, much like a snail, leaving a trail of mucus. When it stops to feed, the collagen lumps up underneath it and hardens. The next time the zooid crawls out, it sits on that lump and secretes more collagen on top. Gradually, the lump gets taller. The next thing you know, Dilley says, you have a tower and a rather silly-looking headless organism perched precariously on top of it, its tentacles flapping in the current, looking far more like a creation of Dr. Seuss's than a hardened survivor of natural selection. Yet terra branches are survivors. The one obstacle to linking them to graptolites has now been overcome, and zoologists can study the living organisms knowing that they are also learning about the long dead. Since his discovery, Dilley has videotaped a different species of terra branch off Bermuda. His footage shows zooids actually crawling out of their holes and making spines, albeit smaller ones than those of sea graptolitoides. In the near future, he plans to dive off Australia's Barrier Reef and in the Florida Keys, and he's hoping to find more living fossils. But he's not getting greedy. Maybe I'll never do it again, he says. But history will always have to put me down as the guy who said that Cephalodiscus graptolitoides was a graptolite, even if it decides to debunk me. What are graptolites? Well, here's a few samples. These are supposed to be floating ones. And you can see there's two of them that are intertwined with each other, probably not originally. Probably they had a tripart structure. Here's another trace. And you can see why somebody would say, well, those aren't living organisms. Here's some more. Here's some with Nema on them. You can see some more. I should say these are from primdesign.com. These ones I managed to get from one of the university, but one of their education department things. Here's another one from the same general area. Here's another one, and that one is from University of Montreal, and there's one from another university site. Well, what's all that noise about? Well, let's take a look at the article by Dilley. Again, you can find this one on the internet as well. A new species of terra branch has been found that has features that could resolve the long-standing arguments by paleontologists about how the fossil graptolites produce their elaborate extracorporeal homes. Many complex and biologically highly unlikely solutions previously proposed can be simplified. This animal is probably classifiable as a graptolite and thus a living fossil representing a group thought to be extinct for 300 million years. And I'll go through the article somewhat and then we'll look at some other stuff. There are 16 recognized species of the pterobranch cephalodiscus. The species are usually described in terms of the structure of the externally secreted home called a conecium. The nature of the zooid, that's a little animal, plays little part in the taxonomic description, which is kind of a little weird if you think about it. How they build their homes is more important than what they look like. It's almost as if you classified birds by the kind of nest they built. This new species is of considerable interest because it has long needle-like spines extending perpendicularly from the conecium. These spines are reminiscent of a spine-like structure, the nema, a feature of several groups of the extinct graptolites. This is the first time this feature has been described in the pterobranches. And the specimens were collected during dive number 9 of the submersible Siana during the 1989 French CALSUB expedition led by Dr. Michel Roux in the New Caledonian Islands. And they give you how deep it was. They give you the latitude and longitude, so you could actually kind of find it if you wanted to. And that's all the materials, because that's all he's got. The pterobranches are found encrusting the surface of the tubes of Vermilopsis associated with dendrophilia. The material as received had been removed from the coral and fixed in formal seawater. So this is a this was found sitting on top of a coral. The specimens are orange in color, consisting of a flattened crust of tissue containing within it many separate sacs, each containing a single adult zooid. The surface of the colony is remarkable for a series of needle-like spines. These spines are up to 3.5 centimeters in length, tapering from a maximum diameter of 0.5 millimeters at the base. It's a little tiny spines, you know, and very, very thin, less than a half a millimeter. They extend outwards at right angles to the surface of the encrusting conecium and inner conecial tissues. And here's plate one. And you can see spines sticking out. And here's one that somehow got bent and repaired. And there's the conecium and zooids. The zooids have not been observed alive. They just dredged this stuff up and then looked at it, and by the time they got to it, the zooids were dead. The fixed zooids are white, about 2 millimeters long and 1 millimeter in diameter, so little bitty things. They appear contracted. In most specimens, the lopophore makes up about 30% of the length. The lopophore is that thing that sticks out and catches stuff. The only zooids that have stalks are those that have reproductive buds. And we'll show you that in a minute. Each bud has its own stalk. It now appears that the idea of a mobile zooid able to freely leave its conecial tube and elaborate its appendages, as suggested by Andreas and Crowther way back in 1980 and 81, is correct. So somebody thought of this, but they said, nah, you can't do that. Well, he could, apparently. And here's a photo of the colony with the little zooids inside of it. And here's one of those little spines coming out. Enlarged, of course. And here's a really enlarged how it was made. You can see that at the end, each time they'd secrete some gunk, and then they'd come back and secrete some more gunk and some more gunk, and in the meantime apply a very, very thin layer of stuff on the outside. And here's a spine that's been cut off, and you can see the internal structure. And there's some holes that are too small for the animals to crawl through except that they do anyway. Apparently they narrow down and slide out. And there's little, if any, reason for not considering C. graptolidoides as a living fossil and a member of the graptolites previously thought to be extinct for over 300 million years. Kozlowski has compared the graptolites within the human chordate pterobranches branches and suggested a close affinity. Kozlowski in 1962 noted that the group of graptolites, the Crustoidea, have many features in common with the recent pterobranches. Branches. With C. graptolidoides, litoides, we now have a pterobranch that is almost indistinguishable from the graptolites. The deep fauna of New Caledonia is known to be rich in living fossils. We now have another to add to the list of those found in this fascinating area. That was short. Well, what's been done with this in the meantime? I mean, this is a ways ago, although I'm betting that very few of you actually heard of this article. Well, in 2012, somebody did something called a phylogenetic analysis, which is basically cladistics, which revealed that Rhabdopleura is an extant graptolite. And this got published in the peer-reviewed literature, so it must be correct. And because of ResearchGate, all of you can look at it too. A phylogenetic analysis of morphological data from modern pterobranch hemichordates, Cephalodiscus, Rhabdopleura, and representatives of each of the major graptolite orders reveals that Rhabdopleura nests among the benthic encrusting graptolitic taxa as it shares all the synaptomorphies that unite the graptolites. Therefore, Rhabdopleurids can be regarded as extant members of the subclass Graptolithinia, or Lithina, class Pterobranchia. So they're all in the same order. Combined with the results of previous molecular phylogenetic studies of extant deuterosomes, these results also suggest that the Graptolithina is a sister taxon to the subclass Cephalodiscida. In other words, they're related to each other. The Graptolithina, as an important component of early to middle Paleozoic biotas, provide data critical to our understanding of early deuterostome phylogeny. Deuterostomes are animals that, when they make their gut, start at the anus and go backwards instead of starting at the mouth and going forward. Those are the protostomes. For what it's worth, embryologically, we're deuterostomes. This result allows one to infer the zooid morphology, mechanics of colony growth, and paleobiology of fossil graptolites in direct relation to the living members of the clade. In other words, we can now study graptolites because we actually have some. And since they're related to us by the standard evolutionary tree, that's kind of important. The subdivision Graptoloida, which are all planktic graptolites, is well supported in this analysis. In addition, we recognize the clade Eugraptolithina. This clade comprises the Graptoloida and all the other common and well-known graptolites of the distinctive Paleozoic fauna. Most of the graptolites, traditionally regarded as tuboids and dendroids, appear to be paraphyletic groups within the Eugraptolithina. However, Epigraptus is probably not a member of this clade. The Eugraptolithina appear to be derived from an encrusting Rhabdopleura-like species, but the available information is insufficient to resolve the phylogeny of basal graptolites. The phylogenetic position of Mastigograptus and the status of Lithicoidea and Mastigraptida also remain unresolved. So what is there? What are they saying in that? There's some answers they don't have. One of the answers they do have is that one of the terror branches, specifically, I'm blanking on that name now too, is actually completely a graptolite, not just a close relative of it. So we definitely have a living fossil of a graptolite. Now they're going to try to put this in perspective before they introduce the data. So they're going to say the small phylum Hemichordata, chordates, of course, are things like lampreys, fish, frogs, reptiles, mammals, and that includes us, and birds. And hemichordates are things that kind of are halfway like us. The small phylum Hemichordata plays a pivotal role in our efforts to understand the pattern of relationships among the three major deuterostome taxa, the nature of the deuterostome ancestor, and the evolutionary origin of the chordates. Historically, hemichordates have been divided into four classes: the extant Enteropneusta, or acorn worms, Planctospheroida, and Pterobranchia, and the extinct Graptolithina. The relationship among the classes is highly uncertain, however. They're setting it up so that now we're going to show you what we found and why it's important. And this confounds efforts to reconstruct deuterostome evolution. You know what that means? They haven't got a tree. All this time that you were told that everything fits in its place on the evolutionary tree, they don't have one. At least not one that everybody can agree on. It is not known whether the pterobranches branches are a sister group to the Enteropneusts or derived within the Enteropneust clade. It is not known whether the monotypic Planctospheroida, rare large planktic larvae, represents a distinct clade of animals or merely hypertrophied ternaria larvae of an Enteropneust. Finally, and the one they're going to solve, we do not know the relationship among the two building groups, the graptolites and the pterobranches. This latter question is the topic of our study. Pterobranches are colonial or pseudocolonial and reproduce via short-lived planula larvae and asexual budding. So they can either bud or they can actually produce the standard male-female type larvae. They produce a collagenous dwelling structure that is commonly called a conecium in the case of pterobranches and a rhabdosome in the cases of graptolites. For simplicity's sake, we will use the term tubarium, so it can apply to both of them, for all of these communal domiciles. The two major orders commonly assigned to the pterobranches are the Cephalodiscoidea and the Rhabdopleurida. Both groups are relatively well known from their living representatives, but have yielded a fairly sparse fossil record. So you can find them in this fossil record. Graptolites, in contrast, have a relatively complete and rich fossil record under the skeletal details, whereas their soft part anatomy is almost completely unknown except for a few poorly preserved remnants. All you can find is the homes. Again, it's as if you were finding birds' nests back there and trying to figure out what the birds look like. Bulman, in 1970, regarded the Pterobranchia and Graptolina as distinct classes. So some people will put them separate. His diagnosis of the Pterobranchia, which matches closely with the most widely used diagnosis for this group, notes that the members of the class are colonial or pseudocolonial, depending on whether they're Rhabdopleura or Cephalodiscus, and possess a shared cuticular tubarium, but otherwise focuses on the soft tissue anatomy of the organisms. Since they're living, we can look at them, we can use how they're put together to try to figure out what their relationships are. In the absence of details of the soft tissue structure of graptolites, graptolites were excluded from the pterobranchia. I love it. Just, you know, we don't have the information, therefore they must be different. On the other hand, Bowman's distinction of the class Graptolithina is the Graptolithina are colonial marine organisms which secreted a sclerotized exoskeleton which characterizes growth bands, fusilli, and growth lines. The initial zooid housed in a conical cicula, and there's a bunch of other descriptions that I'm not going to go through, but I want you to notice that one of the things they did, it has to be a conical cicula. Well, cephalodiscid pterobranches are clearly excluded from the Graptolithina based on this diagnosis, even taking into account recent evidence that their tuberium in its spine-like structure showed a mode of construction similar to that inferred for graptolites. Dilley, 1993. You may recognize that article. In contrast, the only respect in which the rhabdopleurid pterobranches do not fit this diagnosis is the description of the cicula as a conical structure. It's almost as if it was chosen to exclude them. The bushy dendroid graptolites, however, possess a tubular prosicula. In other words, not all the graptolites have that conical structure either. So why do they put it in? Just to exclude the rhabdopleurid pterobranches? Maybe. And moreover, Epigraptus and possibly the crestoids possess a vesicular prosicular very similar to that of rhabdopleura. So you can find graptolites that look like rhabdopleura. Oops. In other words, people have figured out what their conclusion is, and they have drawn their criteria so that they get the answer they want. Character analysis and coding. An assessment of the similarity shared among the set of taxa chosen for analysis is fundamental to any phylogenetic study. We employed the detailed structure of anatomical features that represent a suite of external, internal, astrogenetic, that has to do with the formation of this big mass here, structural features to construct 32 characters. Essentially, all features of these colonies that could be observed in the range of organisms included in this analysis. You don't have graptolite bodies, so you can't say, you know, whether the head is short or, you know, that kind of thing. So all you can do is compare what they make. We also observed one ecological character, character 15, which is the planktic habit. And this is how they score them. Prosicula, this character 0, and if you're wondering why 0, it's because computers like 0 rather than 1 as their first number. Don't worry, it has to do with computer programming. Prosicular absent, vesicular, or tubular. So you get a 0 for absent, you get a 1 for vesicular, and 2 for tubular. And 3 for caudal. And so you can have 3 of them. I'm going to skip over the reasons for that. And number 1 has a helical line which is either absent or present. And number 2 has a metacicular opening in the prosicular, either absent or resorption or primary. Take your pick. And I'm going to skip over all the other ones because otherwise your eyes will glaze over and we'll be here 2 hours from now. But you can see they scored 31 characters and the 32nd one, which is planktic, if you remember. And you'll look at this and there's, you know, it's the first 7 of them and you can see they basically go through, does it have 1 or 2 of these characteristics, and they'll, you know, score it as a 0 or a 1 or an I don't know. And this is standard cladistic analysis. And the taxa included in the analysis, it gives the taxa and reasons why. And he gives a section on cladistic methods and which computer program he used and all that stuff. There are computer programs, you just throw all those numbers in and they'll pop you out a most likely and next most likely and so forth cladistic relationship. And the results do terra branches and graptolites form mutually exclusive groups? And I'm just going to skip down to kind of the bottom line here. And there's the most likely relationship of the various groups. And, okay, there's the cephalodiscids. They are on one end of the branch, so, and if you were to, you know, draw a line here, you could make them into a different group. But the rhabdopleura, as you can see, is nested with Epigraptus, and on one side of the cysticamara from the cephalodiscids, which are, these are all, the unmarked ones are actually graptolites. And so you can see the rhabdopleura fits very nicely in a particular version of the graptolites. Cephalodiscids are related, but you could technically distinguish between them, but the rhabdopleura you can't. Rooting the ptera branch graptolite tree, that's a problem because, of course, it has to have a root. Otherwise, you wouldn't have a you wouldn't have an evolutionary tree. And he rooted a phylogenetic analysis of the Graptolithinae. He has a few paragraphs. Those are long paragraphs, by the way. Sensitivity analysis. How sensitive is this to, well, let's not include this or that feature in our analysis, and just include all the features you can think of. Discussion, interpretation of tree topology. The most profound finding is the discovery that rhabdopleura nests within the clade that includes all graptolites. Therefore, the Graptolithina must be included within the class Pterobranchia. So you can't distinguish between pterobranches branches and graptolites. That is, pterobranches, if you like it, especially the rhabdopleura, are living fossils. The similarities to cephalodiscus are numerous and interesting in this connection as well, including their tube and spine building mechanisms, but we disagree with Dilley and Rigby that these features, which are clearly plesiomorphic relative to the Graptolithina, make cephalodiscus a graptolite. In other words, those features, those spines that everybody was using to distinguish between graptolites and the modern cephalodiscus, well, they're really not that important after all. They could have evolved twice. Comparison to somebody else who did the same job and relationship among the major tube building hemichordates. And finally, this study supports the suggestion of Zajewski, pardon me, my Polish is not very good, that the cysticamarids may be primitive with respect to the tuboids and that some characters may have appeared in a mosaic fashion among these encrusting graptolite groups. What does a mosaic fashion mean? Well, it means sometimes you have one feature and sometimes you have another feature and sometimes you have both features and then sometimes you can have mixtures of three or four or five different features and they don't form a nice tree. Proposed phylogenetic classification, and then we'll skip on to the end of the paragraph. And my thoughts on this are graptolites, which had been thought to be extinct for some 300 million years, have been discovered to be closely related to the living organisms, cephalodiscus and rhabdopleura, or more accurately, their communal products, because we don't actually have the graptolites themselves, all we have is their homes. The latter two organisms can be considered living fossils. They're alive graptolites. Especially rhabdopleura. Graptolites teach us, I think, to be humble. We used to think that graptolites were an internal skeleton. We now believe that they are external structures, like honeycombs or corals. They're not actually the animals, they're just the way their homes were put together. And in fact, Linnaeus was partly right. They were not once living things. They were only the products of those living things. Perhaps the strongest argument for evolution is that the further one goes back in the geologic column, the stranger the organisms get. I used to say the second strongest because I thought that radiometric dating was a good argument. I no longer think that it's as good as it used to be. Evolution explains this naturally. Creation seems to deal with it in an ad hoc way. Well, God just destroyed all those organisms and he didn't have them rebuilt afterwards. Graptolites, trilobites, and dinosaurs are examples of this phenomenon. They were back before and they're not living now. Now, graptolites can be taken from that group and placed with another group. This one easily explained by creationists and not nearly as well by evolutionists, namely living fossils. If extinction in the fossil record really means what it is usually assumed to mean, how does an organism go extinct for 60 or 100 or in this case 300 million years and suddenly show up in the present? Re-evolving is incredible. Living for 300 million years as a small population in some out-of-the-way place and never being fossilized is hard enough to believe by itself. It also tends to undercut the strangeness argument. Perhaps there are trilobites just waiting to be found outside of New Caledonia, or perhaps they just went completely extinct instead of almost extinct. Living fossils such as horseshoe crabs, coelacanths, scouring rushes, ginkgos, and now pterobranchia or graptolites don't prove evolution wrong, but they do significantly change the argument. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn.
Just as an explanatory comment, all these comparisons that you do of cladograms, which are used very extensively, and these are very highly sophisticated studies and complex studies. But the one weakness with cladograms is the basic assumption that evolution is involved in it. It need not be at all involved. It's just a comparison of similarities.
So if you wanted to, for example, you could make a cladogram of automobiles.
Sure, you using certain characteristics, you can make a cladogram that shows that cows and lungfish are more closely related than cows and deer, for instance, simply by picking the right characteristics that happen to emphasize that relationship of a. And so,
that if you made single horns versus branched horns really, really important.
Yeah, it just depends on what characteristics you pick.
And then cows and say triceratops have single horns, and so they must be related more closely than deer, which have branched horns.
Yeah, of course. So. We need to keep that basic thing in mind. Cladograms are very sophisticated. They're worthy of a lot of respect for comparisons only, not for the fact that they are evolutionarily related. It's two different basic assumptions you make there. This is well recognized. You know, cladograms don't mean evolution in the evolutionary, but they're always used that way.
Comment.
I'm trying to figure out, you know, the use of living fossils. Isn't this a contradiction of terms? Because if fossils, I understood it to mean something that is, in fact, extinct. So if they are living examples of those animals, then how can we call them living fossils?
Well, the most common use for this is something that was found in the fossil record to begin with. And everybody thought, oh, those are fossils, and nobody had seen one in real life. And so then you go to the middle of China and you suddenly find a whole forest of ginkgo trees. And they look just like, I mean, the leaves are this, you know, fan-shaped, just like what you see in the fossil record. And they've got to be, you know, very closely related to the ginkgo trees that were fossilized, but nobody was expecting them to be around anymore, because presumably better adapted trees had pushed them out of the way. Well, it turns out they hadn't exactly. And you just had to be in the right place in China to find them, and they're still there. And so that's why the term came to be, is that this is a living fossil. Horseshoe crabs are found, you know, in the fossil record, and they look identical to the ones we have now, but they lived for a while and then suddenly they're gone, and then now they're here. And if you interpret the fossil record as a good record, not a perfect record, everybody knows that, but a good record of the life that you had in the past, then the lack of horseshoe crabs from, you know, whatever their extinction rate was, which I think is probably the Permian or something like that. Horseshoe crabs. Yeah, I don't remember the exact. I do know the graptolites are 300 million years. It's a standard interpretation. They're gone at 300 million years. And now we suddenly have them. And there is, as you can tell, there's this kind of flavor of resistance to the idea that these things can actually be graptolites, because that would make them living fossils. And I think there's a subconscious thing saying, you know, you can't do that. And there may be for some people, I don't know whether for everybody, but there may be for some people a resistance to saying, and that switches them over from an evolutionary argument, you see how strange things were in the past and they are not that way now, to a creationist argument, you see how strange they were, how they're still there, and you don't find them in the fossil record between. Well, that means that maybe the fossil record is incomplete, and the fact that you don't find them now doesn't mean time. See, and that's the difference. Yes.
Yeah. Just to confuse the picture a little bit, but very related to his question, there have been some definitions that in order for something to be a fossil, it has to be at least 10,000 years old. So when you say living fossils, if you follow that particular technicality, you could say, well, there's no such thing as a living fossil. But that's, we understand what we're talking about here.
No, I
don't. Well, the idea originally was that since there's always different pressures on various organisms, that you can't really have a living fossil, that you couldn't have something surviving just the way it was 300, 500 million years ago. And some people will apply that to sharks, which basically have not changed over the last 500 million years. I mean, when they first come into the record, they look pretty much like modern sharks. And they really, you know, the morphology hasn't changed, the skeleton hasn't changed, they look the same. And so people would also call those living fossils because they really haven't changed much.
I just might add, there is a book over here in the library to look at that describes and shows pictures of some of the fossils in the Gunflint Church. Gunflint Church in Canada, near the Great Lakes region. And you have there pictures of Oscillatoria and Spirogyra. These are algae.
That we know from today.
Look exactly like modern ones. And evolutionists recognize this, and they say, well, maybe we're not sure the biochemistry is the same. Just as a means of trying to say they're different. They look exactly like modern Oscillatoria and so on. They have not evolved in 1.9 billion years. That's 1,900 million. If you like million-year figures. And that does raise a little bit of a question about the molecular clock. And it's used as a clock to tell how old things are. Some things look like they have not changed at all. Now, evolutionists would say, well, the environment didn't change, so they didn't evolve. Which explains a little bit. In evolution, you can have all kinds of ideas as long as you believe in the theory at first. And you can find all kinds of things to fit different ideas and different data that you find. And when you once they say, well, it didn't evolve. And when it's different, oh, it did evolve. We're dealing with the past, and evolutionists have this problem. Everybody has this problem. It's not a problem for evolutionists alone, in that our data is not as objective as we'd like. But there are very serious questions there. When you start seeing too many of these things, you wonder, really, is this significant? And I just might add one other point. Graptolites have been used as indexed fossils very much. And when you find something like this, you say, hey, really, are we sure these things are really indexed fossils, or have we just not found them where eventually they'll show up?
Or perhaps the index doesn't have to do with when things evolved. And that's, I think, the really important point, is because this actually challenges the idea of evolutionary time. You see, remember that if you have a flood, it would mix certain stuff and dump it out, and then mix certain stuff and dump it out, and mix certain stuff and dump it out. And each dumping, regardless of where of what kind of organisms you have, would have certain organisms predominate in whatever mix you're making before you dump it out. And it is possible that these graptolites are index fossils only because certain ones of them became predominant in a particular layer, and then other ones became predominant in the layer above. The only prediction you could make from a flood perspective that would be pretty hard would be that most of the time the first mixes should be of bottom-dwelling organisms, and the next mixes should have more floating organisms, which I believe is actually the case. That you don't have as many floating organisms, and the Cambrian is mostly bottom dwellers. So it's in which case actually creation gets maybe a half a point out of that. And it's not clear in an evolutionary perspective why organisms should start all on the bottom and then go to floating organisms and then go up. Unless you're progressively preserving more land, more upper ocean and then land-based stuff. And if that's the case, then ecological zonation makes as much sense as an evolutionary perspective. And The thing of it is, these are kind of soft arguments. They really are. And how soft they are is evidenced by the fact that it took people a long time to figure out the graptolites were, in fact, simply extinct pterobranches, branches, which is now pretty much recognized. What happens is that you have a story that you're going to fit things into. For some people, it's going to be a flood story. For other people, it's going to be an evolutionary story with long ages. When you see something in the record, you're going to try to tell a story about it. And the story you're going to tell depends on what you think the background for your story needs to be. And if it's long ages, and after the first little bit where people were disappointed that the seafloor wasn't the same as it was, they said, well, then evolution must move on from there and not have too many living fossils. And so then they retold the story with the graptolites being extinct. And when they retold the story, they told the story the graptolites must make this stuff inside of them, that what we see is their skeletons, if you please. Whereas, and that story has finally died. Whereas a creationist story could say, whatever that is, that's not a living organism. And that's what Linnaeus said, and he's right. It's the nest or the honeycomb or the coral branch of a living organism. And none of this is probative, but the thing of it is that if you get into a class on evolution, one of the things that they will push on you and push is that at first you had these organisms and then they had other organisms and these organisms died out and we don't have any more of that. And if there really was a creation, wouldn't all of them have been preserved? And we'd know them all from now. Well, it turns out that more of them are preserved than you think. Comment back here. Pass that back, and you've been waiting. So, but pass that back to her. Go ahead, your turn.
I've never been able to reproduce noise. No matter how many times I would repeat an experiment, noise never reproduces the same way. In fact, that's the definition of noise, as opposed to signal. If noise was reproducible, it would be something meaningful. It wouldn't be noise anymore.
It would be pseudo-noise.
Well, you would want to ask,
because
what does this mean?
Because here's the thing. If you have a computer program and you put in random such and such, every time you run the program, it will give you the same random numbers.
Ah, but that's because...
And it's supposed to be chance, but you'll always go to room 3 first and then room...
Yeah. But you see, the random number generators are actually following an algorithm.
Exactly.
And so they appear random, but they are not. In fact, right. There is a whole branch of science that just deals with that question. What I was alluding to, however, was an occasion when I saw a figure of a published paper that looked to me strangely familiar. And I dug up another figure that was published in a paper 5 years earlier.
By the same author?
Well, not all the same authors.
But one of them.
Well, maybe one of them. And when I basically overlaid the two figures, the noise was the same. Now, what does that tell you?
It tells you that paper B copied paper A.
At least some of the data in this figure was simply copied from before. It was not repeated. I could never do that twice. That's impossible. So here we have a process. What we have is a process that is based on random chance. Yes? Uh-huh. That's evolution. Evolution does not pick and choose which organism it works on. It works on all of them randomly. And the longer you have, the less of a chance that you're going to escape evolution somehow. That's not likely, right? So now we have an ever larger number of what are called as fossil that happen to be strangely, unfortunately, not extinct. And so we call them living fossils. To that group, we should add a whole larger number of all the very familiar organisms that we routinely find in the fossil record, such as fish, turtles, snakes, various other things. How come they look so familiar when you look on one of those fossil displays?
Sharks.
Sharks, okay. How come they are not called living fossils? Because we knew them long before we ever saw the fossil. So the fossil didn't surprise us. In this case, we call living fossils things which we first saw as a fossil, and then we were surprised to discover very much alive. But when you add both of these groups together, you end up with a very large number of, shall we say, data of organisms that are present both very much alive as well as in the fossil record. How do we explain evolution somehow missing its target in all of those cases by random chance? How's that randomness supposed to be operating here?
Why didn't they change by now?
Why didn't they change? Why didn't they mutate if mutation is supposed to somehow be the fertilizer for evolution? I'm asking the wrong question.
Anyway, Janet.
You may have already covered this in class, but recently I've heard information, I think it was on National Geographic program, which is evolutionary based, mm-hmm. that there was large quantities of water. They don't, of course, acknowledge the flood. But where, or do you have information on what is the backdrop for, and they kind of alluded to the fact that this was new thinking, that there were large bodies of water, never worldwide.
There's supposed to be much more water in the minerals. Below the oceans than there is in the oceans themselves.
I mean, in terms of hydrates.
In terms of hydrates and so on. It and that's sometimes considered. It's a big question where all this water came from, you know, because we don't see it very much elsewhere in the universe. It's also a question of why there's so much carbon. Here and so on, although there is a little bit of a suggestion that the random changes from in your early elements would favor carbon. But water is a problem. And of course, I have to smile. I shouldn't. we're all ignorant as to how they relate the possibility of water on these planets to life. Oh, that if you have water, you have essentially have life. And I don't think these folks have a host, any suggestion how complex the simplest organism is. They wouldn't say that.
Well, sometimes their theology drives them. Evolutionary theology. Well, you see, it has to be chance. It can't be too bad of a chance, because if it was too bad of a chance, we shouldn't be here either. So life can't be that hard to create. Regardless of what the experimental evidence that we have is, it just can't be that hard to create, because if it were, we wouldn't be here either to ask the question. Because the only resources you have are law and chance and some combination of the two. And so there must be some kind of a law that requires life here. And I say must be because they don't really know what that requirement would be. And certainly from the data we have, we don't have any evidence that life must be easy to create. The data we have strongly suggests it's really hard to create. But it must be, in terms of cosmic time, easy. It must be. Because otherwise, we're here on a fluke too. Well, if it's that easy, then it must have happened somewhere else as well. And the only real requirements are carbon and water. And you zap it with enough electricity, you hit it with ultraviolet rays, or some way put energy into it, and suddenly you have life. And if they have water on Mars, then it must mean life on Mars. Which is why some people were quite sure that there was going to be life on Mars. And if there's water on some planet, exoplanet out, 300 light years from here, then there must be life on that planet too, because it can't be that hard. If it is that hard, then you're starting to look at design, and we don't want to go there.
These folks ought to take courses in biochemistry.
I noticed that the biochemists are not nearly as good atheists as the evolutionary biologists. Comment here.
Well, talk about life. How many enzymes does it take for any process to happen within the body? I mean, take the bleeding process, bleeding cascade. Take hemoglobin, and how many enzymes, enzymatic relationships involved in that? All those amino acids to be put together. Yes, life, yeah, it did happen. There is an amino acid that came from a spark somewhere. Yeah. And then what?
How do you put them together again?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, how could anyone, how could this biochemist, how could this, is it that they have suddenly said, we are God, I am God. There's no one else is needed because I have all this wealth of knowledge. I have so much of it that I cannot accept a notion that there is someone beyond me. And if you talk about it, you're an absolute idiot.
Yeah.
You see, today I'm sitting, protozoa, is that a... was protozoa, we talked about it, flagellum, a few Sabbaths back. Was that a Cambrian, Precambrian, or...?
As far as I know, I don't know that they found fossil flagella in the Precambrian, but I wouldn't be surprised if they did.
Okay, just to think.
Yeah, that's part of the point.
The thing is that the outboard machine, the perfect machine, the flagellum could be spinning at 100,000 RPM per minute, 100,000 times, and it would stop and reverse within one quarter of a spin. This could be, when they say that life came in this world, a perfect machine. Perfect.
Well, it's certainly... much more optimal than we've been able to create at that scale.
Yeah.
And, you know, today sitting in your class, I said, am I having a nightmare? I'm sitting, you know, 40 years back in the zoology class, but this was interesting, of course. So, but, you know, it just, shark, for example, and then genes, for example, you know, you put a fish in a cave in Hawaii, and within 6 weeks, it loses its eyesight. It's amazing. Don't need this function anymore. Well, shut it off, you know. I mean,
yeah.
Turn it off. It's, we are fearfully and amazingly made, wonderfully made. That's all we can say.
Yeah. We have a comment over here, Pastor.
I was curious if the geologic column that you see in textbooks appears everywhere in every place around the world, and if so or if not, why don't we see these living fossils in each of these layers, or should we expect to see them in each of these layers, and if we don't, why don't we?
Well, I suspect that the flood probably did make some organisms close enough to extinct to where they were either extinct after the flood immediately, or perhaps they lived on for a few hundred years and then died out. I mean, the condors are in the process of doing that right now, the California condors. As some of you know, there's 17 of them left or something like that at one point, and they're trying desperately to rehatch them, but after a species gets down to only a very few individuals, if one is not careful, first of all, you know, some of them die on their own because of random non-genetic factors, like poisoned meat or hunters with shotguns, you know. And then secondly, if they have genetic defects, they pass them on to their kids, and there's nobody else to counterbalance that. And at a certain point, you simply lose the genetic ability to continue on. And so there's genetic entropy. They don't call it that, but that's what it is. A small enough group will go extinct just from that reason alone, even if suddenly people realize, oh, we're about to lose the dodo, and everybody stops killing them, you still have individuals continue to die off. That happened to the passenger pigeon. The last one that died was actually in captivity, where we could protect it from outside environments. It died anyway in 1914.
But unlike the dodo, my understanding is that there are certain of these fossils are still living.
That's
correct.
Right.
So why don't they appear? I'm assuming that they don't. That
if they appear in, let's say, the Devonian as their last or the Carboniferous, why in the world don't you have them in the Permian and then in the Triassic?
Precisely.
Yeah. Well, the best explanation, I think, from both people are fossils were being gotten from elsewhere to be made.
What does that mean?
Specifically, in those cases, most of the later fossils are terrestrial anyway, where you wouldn't expect to have graptolites. But you see, that explanation completely ruins the argument that was being made that, you see, the further back you go, the stranger things are, and that means that they've evolved from that to something else. What it means is, no, they were just living elsewhere from what was being collected at the time and fossilized.
So their argument is they went extinct and they've re-evolved?
That's pretty hard to do because of the factor that he was talking about. What do you do with noise? How do you re-evolve something that went extinct once? How do you get it to come back exactly the same way? There should be some differences.
If they didn't re-evolve, where did they go?
Well, they were hiding somewhere.
Okay.
Obviously.
Okay.
And you see, the point of it is, but if they were hiding there, they could have been hiding from the flood in the same way. And all of a sudden, your argument from strangeness disappears.
You can't have all organisms everywhere.
Yeah, there are certain limitations. There are going to be certain bottlenecks when it is really hard to see evidence of presence of an organism, but absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. As I'm sure you're familiar with. But to address the other question that is implicit in your question is that how do we know when something's extinct? Just because we don't see it, does that mean it's extinct? Well, it may be, but it may also be in some sequestered area that from which it may reemerge. Sort of like some of these diseases that reemerge after certain number of decades or so.
Or the snail that was thought to be extinct on one of the islands in the sea off of Madagascar.
Right.
Seychelles, I think it was. But there's an island there that had a snail and it went extinct, and this is evidence for global warming. And direct evidence for global warming, and then it reappeared.
Oops. That goes back to my first question: was does the geological column, as we see in the textbook, appear everywhere exactly as it appears in the textbook around the world? And if it does not, which I think is what you're saying, it may not. Then how can we take one area that we find it and transpose it onto all things at all times in all other areas?
The question being, is the geologic record complete in all the world at the same time? The answer is no, it's not complete in, for example, in the Grand Canyon, which is kind of famous around here. There's a complete lack of deposition from the Cambrian to, what is it, the Devonian or so?
You're talking about the gap.
The Ordovician and the Silurian are completely gone.
Are missing in the Grand Canyon. Ordovician and Silurian are missing in the Grand Canyon.
So if there were Ordovician organisms, either from Ordovician places where the flood picked them up, or from the Ordovician period, if you're an evolutionist, if you look in the Grand Canyon, you won't find them, period. Because it's not being deposited there.
You can make the statement that nowhere on the earth is there a complete geologic column. And that depends on what details you want. The other side of that is that the main parts are represented on probably all the continents. I'm talking about Paleozoic, Mesozoic, Cenozoic.
That, for example, in the Grand Canyon, you don't find them in quite a ways around it, but if you go far enough out somewhere, like perhaps in the Appalachians, you will find it.
So the column is represented around the world in a very general way. It is not at all around the world in details.
Comment here.
It's interesting that Dr. Downs, you know, is the biology professor at La Sierra for many years. For his PhD research, he was granted permission to go into the catacombs of the down in LA where they have that Museum of Natural History, and he was able to go into their closed rooms that are off limits to the general public, and he found evidence of all sorts of interesting things that did not fit the record for evolution hidden away there from the general public because it didn't fit their scheme of things.
You're talking about finding modern mammals with the dinosaurs and stuff like that. You know, ordinarily I'd be tempted to say, well, that sounds like a conspiracy theory. The only problem is that I've seen conspiracy theories out in the open with the suppression of data from carbon-14, for example, that make me think, well, maybe one should give a little more credence to things like that. Anyway, next week come back and we'll have some fun with RNA viruses and how they evolve much more rapidly than they're supposed to.